Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Good evening, Kapil. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, good evening.
Good evening,
Kapil. Good evening, sir. So, how is the COVID problems in Jayadeva?
That's quite bad only, sir. All our wards are full COVID ICUs.
Yeah. I think it's a big problem now. Even interventions, all these things, I think.
Yeah, it has come down, sir. All our elective admission surgeries.
Otherwise, everybody gets exposed and very difficult situation.
Yeah, tomorrow onwards, re-lock. So.
Yeah. I think 2 weeks, sir.
2 weeks.
Yes, sir.
It's almost like curfew only. Maybe little less, sir. I think it is required now, at least to break the cycle. Yeah.
So are my slides visible as full screen?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
I think Anger, okay. Sir, we can start. Sir. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this our Monday musings, what we call. And we know that when we see a case of heart failure, about 50% of them are due to heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. And another probably 15 to 30% out of that may have one of these pathologies like constrictive physiology or restrictive physiology. So Dr. Kapil Rangan, who is the Associate Professor of Cardiology at the Jayadeva Institute, is going to talk to us. He's a young and enthusiastic professional cardiologist with a lot of interest in academics. So over to you, Kapil.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your kind words. And thank you to the Manipal Academy for giving me this opportunity to take part in this program. This is, as sir said, this is an important topic, not only from the clinical perspective, but also from the academic perspective for students who are students of cardiology. So I will try to make this a combination of clinical and also stress on some of the academic points that may be important for the exams. So here is a brief outline of my talk. I hope to be able to finish in the given time of 45 minutes. I'll briefly define the conditions, constriction and restriction, a few hemodynamic points, clinically how to recognize these conditions, what are the similarities and differences between constrictive pericarditis and restrictive cardiomyopathy, and how we can proceed to investigate and try to reach a diagnosis. Now, as the term constrict implies, it is the act of making something narrow. So it is like strangulating or squeezing. So by definition itself, it implies that there is an external force which is kind of compressing the heart from outside. Whereas restriction is a condition which exerts internal limitation or restraint, which means that the pathology is from within the heart itself and not due to an external compression. So constrictive pericarditis is a condition in which there is a thickened, non-compliant, adherent and calcific pericardium, which externally limits the diastolic filling of the cardiac chambers. So this is the definition of constrictive pericarditis. I won't go into much of the etiological factors. We all know that the common conditions in our setup are bacterial tubercular and sometimes post-traumatic, post-surgical or other chronic inflammatory diseases. On the other hand, restrictive cardiomyopathy is a condition wherein the ventricle itself is stiff and non-compliant, and this impedes relaxation and diastolic filling, resulting in heart failure. So this is the primary difference between the two entities of restrictive cardiomyopathy and constrictive pericarditis. Again, restrictive cardiomyopathies can be classified into either myocardial diseases, which can be infiltrative and non-infiltrative. I won't go into the details. It can be endomyocardial diseases where there is endocardial as well as myocardial inflammation like endomyocardial fibrosis and storage disorders. Now, why is it important for us clinically to differentiate the two conditions? Because essentially constrictive pericarditis, if it is diagnosed on time, it is a treatable condition. Timely surgery in the form of total pericardiectomy can relieve the pericardial compression on the chambers, and in the absence of concomitant myocardial dysfunction, which means if the entity is diagnosed on time before additional myocardial damage has occurred, then we can actually restore the normal hemodynamics and we can relieve the patient of the symptoms. Now, coming to restrictive cardiomyopathy, because the problem lies within the myocardium itself, there are very limited therapeutic options. There are upcoming drugs for specific conditions. Again, I will not be going into those details. Now, a little bit of about the hemodynamics of ventricular filling or diastology. So as we know, the ventricular filling is consists of three phases: the early rapid filling, the late diastolic or the mid diastolic filling, otherwise called diastasis, and atrial contraction. So the determinants of these different stages are, for early rapid filling, it is the ventricular relaxation, active relaxation of the ventricle is one of the determinants of early rapid filling. Then you have the gradient across the atrioventricular valve. In this case, I mean, we're talking about the mitral valve. So that is another determinant of early rapid filling. And then of course, the pericardial restraint. So what's important to note is that in the early rapid filling, pericardial restraint does not really play a big role in this particular phase of ventricular filling. Whereas as we move on to mid-diastolic or late-diastolic filling, the ventricular relaxation continues. There is pericardial restraint because now the ventricle is coming in contact with the pericardium and you have interventricular connections. So this is what determines the late-diastolic filling. Then, of course, you have the atrial contraction, which is determined by how healthy the atrium is, if the patient is in sinus rhythm or if there's any atrial myocardial atrial cardiomyopathy, then you will have impairment of atrial filling. So moving on to the hemodynamic considerations, what is the characteristic hemodynamic feature which is exhibited by both constriction as well as restrictive cardiomyopathy is an impairment to diastolic ventricular filling. So as I mentioned before, in CP, there is an external compression, and in restrictive cardiomyopathy, there is an intrinsic myocardial pathology. There can be a mixed pattern. I'll be coming to that a little later in my presentation, where you can have an overlap of constrictive and restrictive features. And that again becomes a clinical challenge as well as a therapeutic challenge. So diastolic dysfunction is universal in both constrictive pericarditis as well as restrictive cardiomyopathy. This is characterized by elevation of ventricular filling pressures and elevation of mean atrial pressures. Usually all the filling pressures across the four chambers will be equalized in this particular condition. What's important to note again is that in constrictive pericarditis, the rapid filling phase, as I mentioned earlier, the rapid filling phase is largely determined by the negative DP by DT of the ventricle and the gradient across the atrioventricular valve. So this particular phase is preserved in constrictive pericarditis, whereas in restrictive cardiomyopathy, there is a pan-diastolic limitation of the ventricular filling. This is an important thing which we're going to keep coming back to during the presentation. Now coming to the normal respirophasic hemodynamics, this is a very important points. So I'd like to spend a little bit of time on this slide because this is what helps us to understand and explain some of the clinical features as well as the echo features in constrictive pericarditis. So as we know, the pericardium encases both the ventricles. the right atrium and most of the left atrium. So there is part of the left atrium where the pulmonary veins are getting attached as extra pericardial, whereas all the other chambers are intrapericardial. So the pulmonary veins and the systemic veins are extra pericardial, but in addition, the systemic veins are extra thoracic as well. That is, the SVC and the IVC are extra thoracic, whereas the pulmonary veins are intrathoracic. So when there is an inspiratory drop in the intrathoracic pressure, this drop is transmitted to the intrathoracic structures, that is the pulmonary veins and the cardiac chambers. But this drop is not transmitted to the systemic veins, which is what is responsible for the increased systemic venous return during inspiration. So the SVC and IVC now actually increase the blood flow to the heart, to the right atrium, because there is a fall in intrathoracic pressure, which is transmitted to the right atrium, but not to the SVC and the IVC. Now, on the left side, you find that since the pulmonary veins, as well as the left atrium and left ventricle, are all intrathoracic structures, there is a uniform transmission of negative intrathoracic pressure to the pulmonary veins, left atrium, and left ventricle. And therefore, there is not much of a change in the gradient between the pulmonary veins and the left atrium during inspiration. So it's important to note here itself that the normal flow in the pulmonary veins is not respirophasic, whereas the flow in the systemic veins is respirophasic. Now, what happens with constrictive pericarditis? With constrictive pericarditis, the thickened pericardium, the calcific pericardium, which is encasing the cardiac structures, creates a dissociation between the intrathoracic and intracardiac pressures. That is, it does not allow the negative intrathoracic pressure to be transmitted to the cardiac structures. So here we have a problem, because now with inspiration, there is the pulmonary veins, which are extra pericardial but intrathoracic, have a drop in the pressure because of negative intrathoracic pressure. Whereas the cardiac chambers, which are now insulated from the rest of the intrathoracic structures due to the constriction, they do not have a drop in pressure. So there is a decrease in the gradient between the pulmonary veins and the left atrium during inspiration in patients with constrictive pericarditis. So this is a very important point. So here you find that there is a respirophasic change in the pulmonary venous flow as well, because of this particular feature, that there is an intrathoracic and intracardiac dissociation. The next important hemodynamic point which distinguishes, or which is a hallmark of constrictive pericarditis, is exaggerated interventricular dependence. So since the pericardium encases the heart and the pericardium is inelastic, when there is constriction, the total cardiac volume within the pericardium is fixed, and therefore when the ventricles have to fill, or when any of the chambers have to fill, they have to fill at the expense of each other. So when the right ventricle is filling, then automatically the left ventricular filling comes down, and vice versa. So this is called exaggerated interventricular independence. And the uniform compression of the cardiac chambers by the pericardium results in equalization of the diastolic filling pressures of all the chambers. This is otherwise called as diastolic democracy. I hope this particular hemodynamic aspect has been clearly understood by the students. So this is a diagram, again, which just describes what I mentioned. During inspiration, normally there is an increase in the flow into the right atrium and the right ventricle due to the drop in intrathoracic pressure. Now, since the pericardium is causing a constraint on the ventricles, during inspiration, if you can just follow the mouse, the right ventricular filling, right ventricular volume increases, the interventricular septum bulges into the left side and compromises the left ventricular filling. At the same time, because there is a decrease in the pulmonary venous pressure without a concomitant decrease in left atrial pressure, the filling into the left heart becomes dramatically reduced. This is what happens during inspiration, and the exact opposite of this happens during expiration, because during expiration, the intrathoracic pressure goes up. So this is a summary slide which I've taken from a review article, which actually describes, it summarizes the hemodynamic features of constrictive pericarditis. So you have an inelastic pericardium, which causes two things. It fixes the pericardial volume, and therefore the ventricles are obliged to depend to fill at the expense of each other. This is called exaggerated interventricular dependence. Two, it dissociates the intrathoracic and intracardiac pressures and therefore reduces the pulmonary venous to left atrial gradient during inspiration and then reduces LV filling during inspiration. So this is the basic summary of the hemodynamics of constrictive pericarditis. Now, coming on to a little bit of the hemodynamic tracings that we have. So in constrictive pericarditis, one of the important things, even in the exam, when you have a case of constriction versus restriction, there's a lot of importance given to the jugular venous pressure, clinical assessment of the JVP. So one of the important features here, if you can focus on the red lines, the red line indicates the RA pressure tracing. So in constrictive pericarditis, so just a minute. Just a minute, sir. I need to connect my charger to my computer. Hello?
Yeah, it's fine. Yeah, take it.
Just a minute, sir.
Yeah, please. Yeah. My audible? Sorry, sir, for that brief interruption. Am I audible? Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, sir. So I was talking about the jugular venous pressure tracings and constrictive pericarditis versus restrictive cardiomyopathy. So what's important to note here, if you're following the red lines, is that in constrictive pericarditis, both the X as well as the Y descents are prominent. The reason being, the X descent is prominent because of preserved atrial relaxation, because the atrial myocardium is essentially healthy in constrictive pericarditis, as well as preserved longitudinal motion of the right ventricle. So when the right ventricle moves in systole, there's downward movement of the tricuspid annulus, which causes the X descent to be prominent. So that's why the X descent is prominent in CP. Whereas in restrictive cardiomyopathy, you have only a prominent Y descent. The X descent is not prominent in restrictive cardiomyopathy because the atrium is also diseased. The atrial relaxation does not happen normally. The second point is, since the ventricle is diseased and the ventricular longitudinal motion is also reduced in restrictive cardiomyopathy, the X descent is not prominent. So you have a prominent Y in both conditions, but a prominent X is seen only in constrictive pericarditis. Some of the other prominent important hemodynamic findings in constrictive pericarditis are the square root sign or the dip and plateau sign, because there is an increase in the early rapid filling phase although the duration is shorter, there is an increase in the amplitude of early rapid filling because most of the filling occurs in the early phase of diastole. So this is manifested by a dip and plateau sign, where there is a dramatic drop in the pressure, and the left ventricular rapid filling wave, which if it is more than 7 millimeters of mercury, that is one of the findings which is very specific for constrictive pericarditis. The next thing is ventricular discordance. So if you have a simultaneous tracing between the left ventricle and the right ventricle, you find that you're able to demonstrate what is called ventricular discordance. That is, with respiration, there is a decrease, there is a phasic filling of the left ventricle. At the same time, when the left ventricular filling comes down, the right ventricular filling actually filling, and therefore the pressure also actually increases. So this discordant pattern is actually very specific for constrictive pericarditis, and this is not seen in restrictive cardiomyopathy. Now, this ventricular discordance has been quantified in the form of systolic area index. This was also this is an important paper which was published. So systolic area index is nothing but the ratio of the RV area, that is the area under the curve here, to the LV area in inspiration divided by expiration. So this particular index has been found to be 100% specific for constrictive pericarditis. So to summarize what I described in the hemodynamics, the important hemodynamic differences between both conditions. As I said, the prominent Y descent can be present in both conditions, but a prominent X descent is usually seen only in constrictive pericarditis. Important caveat here would be the presence of atrial fibrillation. The X descent can be absent altogether, and that makes the clinical differentiation a little bit difficult. Now, equalization of the left-sided and right-sided filling pressures is usually present in both, but in restrictive cardiomyopathy, because of intrinsic disease of the ventricle itself, the left ventricular filling pressures tend to be higher than the right, and usually the difference is more than 5 millimeters of mercury. The square root sign, again, is present in both conditions, but more prominently seen in CP. Extremely high filling pressures, like more than 25 millimeters of mercury, are seen only in restrictive cardiomyopathy, not in CP. And this correlates with the pulmonary artery systolic pressure as well. Important index is the ratio of RV end-diastolic pressure to RV systolic pressure. It's usually more than one-third in CP, whereas in restrictive cardiomyopathy, it is less than one-third. A gradient between the pulmonary capillary wedge and the left ventricular diastolic pressure at the first beat of inspiration is usually seen. It's a classical finding of constrictive pericarditis, but it is absent in restrictive cardiomyopathy. Ventricular tracings show a discordant pattern in CP, whereas they show a concordant pattern in restriction. And as I described, the rapid filling phase is usually more than 7 millimeters in CP. Just to make a mention here, even in tamponade, there is an external limitation of the ventricular filling, but that is caused by fluid in the pericardial cavity and not by the pericardium itself. Therefore, it tends to be pan-diastolic. So this is an important feature to distinguish tamponade from constriction, that in tamponade, there is a uniform limitation to the ventricular filling throughout the cardiac cycle, whereas in constriction, the early diastolic phase is characteristically spared. That's why you see more of ventricular interdependence in tamponade than in constrictive pericarditis, which translates to more of pulsus paradoxus seen in cardiac tamponade versus constriction. Now, this particular feature of some of the overlapping features of tamponade can be seen in patients with effusive constrictive pericarditis. So that's an important thing you need to keep in mind. Coming to the pulmonary systolic pressures, as I mentioned, the systolic pressure, if it is more than 45 millimeters of mercury, it's usually an indication of restrictive cardiomyopathy. It indicates intrinsic myocardial disease. But in clinical practice, we do find patients with CP having high pulmonary systolic pressures. Some of the conditions which we need to keep in mind if the PA pressure is high are mixed constriction and restriction, which can happen in post-irradiation or post-surgical scenarios. If they have associated pulmonary disease, for example, if there is a core pulmonale with the constrictive pericarditis, you might have high pulmonary pressures. If the constriction involves the AV groove, causing external mitral stenosis, causing the LA pressures to elevate, then you might have venous hypertension, which translates into pulmonary arterial hypertension. And in the very late stages of constriction itself, when there is myocardial involvement by the fibrotic process, then the end-diastolic pressures can go up and the PA pressures also can go up. Just a summary about what happens in restriction. So the important thing to know in restrictive cardiomyopathy is that there is no dissociation between the intrathoracic and intracardiac pressures. So all the pressure changes which happen during inspiration expiration are uniformly transmitted to the cardiac chambers. So there is an absence of diastolic democracy in this condition, and there is ventricular concordance. And the important thing is usually because the interventricular septum is also involved in the disease process. So there is the interdependence between the two ventricles is largely limited because the septum is not compliant enough to move from side to side. And again, pulmonary arterial hypertension is more common because of myocardial disease. And you can get inspiratory flow reversals in the hepatic vein. That is the clinical correlate is the Kussmaul sign. few important things we need to keep in mind when we are doing the hemodynamic assessment of these patients. One is hypovolemia or gross congestive heart failure can mask some of these clinical and hemodynamic signs. So we need to make sure that the patient is optimally hydrated when we are doing the hemodynamic assessment. Again, there can be a confusion when you have effusive constrictive pattern that you can have some features of tamponade as well as some features of constriction. Important is to know if there is an AV groove constriction causing mitral stenosis-like features, then you may not have the equalization of pressures. In general, the left atrial pressure will be higher in those patients. And in patients who do not have an intact interventricular septum, you will not be able to demonstrate the ventricular discordance. And as I mentioned earlier, atrial fibrillation interferes with the hemodynamic assessment because of beat to beat variation. Just to make a mention, there are a few other conditions which can cause this kind of restrictive pattern, that is a prominent dip and plateau sign on the hemodynamics, such as RV infarction, acute pulmonary embolism, acute severe MR or TR. I will not be going into these details. Now, coming on to the mixed picture of restriction and constriction, the exact prevalence of this is not known, but there are some reports which say it is around 10 to 15%. So mixed constriction and restriction, if we do see a pattern, we need to keep in mind either radiation-induced cardiac disease, sequelae of myopericarditis, post-operative constriction with some amount of myocardial damage caused by the surgery itself, and the very late stages of CP where there is myocardial fibrosis. So in these particular patients, it's difficult to exactly determine how much of it is restriction and how much is constriction. But the overall thing is, even some of them may or may not respond to pericardiectomy. So there you really have to take a gamble and see if the patient is going to respond to the to pericardiectomy. Overall, the prognosis is poor. Moving on to some of the clinical and echocardiographic features, I think. I have another 20 minutes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Please go ahead.
So the entire dilemma of constriction and restriction arises because they both present in the same clinical manner. They present with predominantly right heart failure features such as fatigue, abdominal distension, anasarca, peripheral edema, elevated jugular venous pressure, ascites. So this is something which is why these two entities have been always compared in clinical practice. A few of the clinical features which help us to distinguish between the two entities. The JVP, as I've already elaborated before, I won't go into that. The apical impulse, usually in patients with constrictive pericarditis, the apical impulse is absent or not prominent, whereas in RCM, it's usually felt. Coming to heart sounds, a pericardial knock, again, it's a very insensitive clinical finding, but if it is present, then it can indicate that this could be a constriction, whereas an S4 is more common with restrictive cardiomyopathy. Atrial fibrillation has been described in around 10 to, some studies also have described around 30% in CP, whereas it is a very common clinical finding in RCM. Almost easily more than 50% of RCM patients will have atrial fibrillation. This is because the atria are essentially dilated in RCM and not so in CP. Pulsus paradoxus, as I mentioned earlier, it is again present in 1/3 of patients with CP, but it is not present in RCM. This is very important. This helps us to distinguish. Pulsus paradoxus basically demonstrates exaggerated ventricular interdependence. Regurgitant murmurs are usually conspicuously absent in CP patients. But if you have a prominent regurgitant murmur like an MR or a TR murmur, it's most likely to be an RCM and not a constrictive pericarditis. Again, conduction disturbances, because the intrinsic pathology can involve the conduction system, it is more common to find conduction blocks in patients with RCM, not in CP, although the calcification may involve the AV node and the conduction system, but that's very rare. Signs of pulmonary hypertension, again, if they are present, clinical signs, if they are present, then it usually favors RCM as compared to constrictive pericarditis. I'll move on to some important investigations that help us to distinguish between these two entities. Echo is by far the mainstay of our modalities which we use to differentiate and where we can demonstrate these hemodynamic differences between the two conditions. Now, of course, we have better investigative modalities like CT and MRI, which actually help us to distinguish these entities. Cardiac cath also has a role. I'll elaborate in a few slides. So the important things that we look for in the echo is, one is anatomical features. Then we look at the Doppler. Pulse wave Doppler plays a very important role in distinguishing these two entities and demonstrating the hemodynamics. Color Doppler to look for AV valve regurgitation and the color M mode. Then tissue Doppler is very important. And then, of course, there are some advanced echocardiographic parameters. Now, the important anatomical features that help us to distinguish between the two entities, I have summarized in this particular slide. So in general, ventricular thickness is normal in constrictive pericarditis because the disease is not in the ventricles. Whereas in restrictive cardiomyopathy, especially infiltrative and storage disorders, there can be an increase in the ventricular thickness. Again, ventricular size also is usually small. Both conditions are characterized by small ventricles, but in the end stage, the ventricles can dilate. Atriomegaly is usually a feature, consistent feature of restrictive cardiomyopathy. Both the atria are usually significantly dilated, but in constriction, the atria are normal in size with the rare exception of AV groove constriction. Ventricular systolic function is preserved in both these conditions. As Sir mentioned in the beginning, both of them present with heart failure with a preserved ventricular ejection fraction. Septal bounce is the characteristic feature which demonstrates interventricular dependence, which is seen in CP but not seen in restrictive cardiomyopathy. Involvement of the valves in the form of valvular thickening, valvular regurgitation is a feature of RCM and it is not seen in constrictive pericarditis. Pericardial effusion can be seen in both conditions. However, thickening of the pericardium is a feature of constriction, which is not seen in RCM. Other important things that we need to look for are obliteration of the apex, ventricular apices. If they are obliterated, that again favors a restrictive pathology, as well as mural thrombi, although mural thrombi can occur in both conditions. Plethora of the IVC is a universal finding in both conditions. Now, when we look at definition of pericardial thickening, now the normal thickness is usually less than 2 millimeters. On echocardiography, especially transesophageal echo, thickness of more than 3 millimeters is taken as significant. And by other imaging modalities like CT or MRI, a thickness of the pericardium more than 4 millimeters is taken as a significant feature to suggest that this could be constrictive pericarditis. It's important at this point to recognize that 1 out of 5 patients, there is 20% of patients who have constrictive pericarditis may not have thickening of the pericardium. So this is an important thing. If you're able to demonstrate the physiology of constrictive pericarditis, but the pericardial thickness is normal, it could still be a CP. For want of time, I think I'll skip the slide on M mode. The most important finding that we look at in the M mode is the septal bounce or the double dip pattern. I'll just show you that. So this is an M mode again showing the dilated left atrium. This is the typical double dip pattern. If you're looking at the septal, the M mode of the interventricular septum, you can see in each cardiac cycle, the septum moves twice up and down. So this pattern, like an M pattern or a W pattern, is seen on the M mode of the interventricular septum. This is very characteristic of constrictive pericarditis. On 2D echo, you can see the septal bounce with inspiration. Clearly, the septum moves between the LV and the RV. So this is a characteristic finding. This is also appreciated in cardiac MRI. I'll show you a picture later. This particular patient with CP had pericardial effusion as well as there a small thrombus in the right atrium. This particular, this is an old slide. So obviously Bangalore used to look like this at one point of time before Corona hit us. So there is a sign dedicated to our dear city and that's called the traffic jam sign, where there is IVC plethora with spontaneous echo contrast in the IVC. So this is an important sign. Again, this can be present both in CP as well as restrictive cardiomyopathy. Now moving on to cardiac cath, the indications are very few to do a cardiac cath unless you want to really demonstrate the hemodynamics. So you can the main indication is to look for the ventricular interdependence and diagnose constrictive pericarditis based on that. To look for the PA pressures to see if there is significant pulmonary hypertension. If you are suspecting AV groove constriction and you want to look at the left atrial pressure, again, you need to do a cardiac cath. And of course, to see the coronaries. So I have a few fluoroscopic pictures which are showing the significant pericardial calcification in a patient with constrictive pericarditis. You can see it's almost a uniform calcification of the pericardium. This is another case where you can see a prominent left atrial appendage pulsations because the entire apex and the AV groove is calcified. So the left atrial appendage is almost pulsating like a pulmonary artery there. And then there is the sign of coronary entrapment, usually seen in the right coronary artery. Because of the pericardial encasement, the mobility of the right coronary artery is significantly reduced. This is called coronary entrapment sign. Now, moving on to restrictive cardiomyopathy, just a few echo images. Here you can see there is this is a patient with cardiac amyloidosis and restrictive cardiomyopathy. You can see the thickening of the ventricular wall, the sparkling granular texture, echo texture of the ventricles. And this patient also has some systolic dysfunction of the left ventricle. So generally they will have significant mitral or tricuspid regurgitation because of involvement of the AV valves by the disease pathology. The IVC can be dilated there. This is a patient with endomyocardial fibrosis, eosinophilic endocarditis, where you can see the apex of the right ventricle and left ventricle are obliterated because of the infiltrative, the inflammation and the infiltrative process. So if you're not able to clearly see, you can even do a contrast echo to demonstrate. This is the same patient with eosinophilic endomyocarditis, where you can see the entire apex is obliterated. Again, this is a classical appearance of cardiac amyloid, thickened ventricles with a sparkling echo texture. The pericardial effusion is again almost universal in these patients. So here you don't see a septal bounce in these patients. You don't see a septal bounce and there is no ventricular interdependence. Thickening of the interatrial septum, again, a classically described feature of cardiac amyloidosis, which was seen in this particular case. Now, a little bit about the pulse wave Doppler, because pulse wave and tissue Doppler are two important diagnostic tools for us to diagnose constriction literally at the bedside. So invariably pulse wave Doppler in both CP as well as RCM will show a restrictive filling pattern. That is the E by A ratio across the mitral inflow will be more than two. There'll be shortening of the deceleration time. However, the phasic variations that we normally see in the right heart are exaggerated in patients with constrictive pericarditis. So if you have a phasic variation in the left heart, especially if you're seeing phasic variations in the pulmonary venous flow, as well as in the mitral inflow, that indicates that this could be a constrictive pericarditis. So the cutoff criteria for mitral E-wave phasic variation is 25%, and for pulmonary venous velocities, it's 18%. So this is what helps us to diagnose constriction using pulse wave Doppler. This is just an illustration of the pulse wave Doppler changes that happen. So if you look at the pulmonary veins, there will be an expiratory increase in the pulmonary venous flow. If you look at the systemic veins, there'll be an inspiratory increase. And if you're looking at reversals, flow reversals, in inspiration, there is a flow reversal in the hepatic veins. So In constrictive pericarditis, there's an expiratory flow reversal in the hepatic veins. In restrictive cardiomyopathy, there is an inspiratory flow reversal in the hepatic veins. So these are important things. Now, the advantage of looking at hepatic venous flow reversal is that it is unaffected by atrial fibrillation. So it can be used even in patients with AF to determine the restrictive physiology. I'll skip this slide. So this is just to show the E by A ratio, which is more than two. In restrictive, this is a patient with cardiac amyloid that I showed you. So you can see throughout respiration, there is no change in the E wave velocity of the mitral Doppler. Again, I will just skip this particular slide. color Doppler, as I said, we have to look for valve regurgitation, and color mode, again, this is largely an outdated modality to diagnose constrictive pericarditis. So you look at the propagation velocity in the left ventricle. If it is increased, it usually suggests constrictive pericarditis. I'll spend a little time on tissue Doppler because this is very important. Tissue Doppler is probably the single most important modality which can distinguish between CP and RCM as far as echo is concerned. So in constrictive pericarditis, because of preserved longitudinal motion of the ventricle during systole, the tissue Doppler velocity is usually increased. So a cutoff of the tissue Doppler velocity of more than 8 cm per second is taken as the cutoff to diagnose constrictive pericarditis. Now, two important tissue Doppler signs which have been described. This is just to compare. So this is a patient with constrictive pericarditis. The E wave, the E prime velocity is increased in this patient. It is more than 10. Whereas in restrictive cardiomyopathy, it is about 5 to 6 in this particular case. Now, if you look at the annular velocities on tissue Doppler, you find that there is something called annulus paradoxus, which has been described in constrictive pericarditis. So in this, because with worsening pericardial constriction or pericardial restraint, the longitudinal motion of the left the ventricle actually increases because the ventricle is now trying to correspondingly fill faster and better during the early diastolic phase. So there is an increase in the annular tissue velocity of the ventricle with worsening constriction. Now this, therefore, the E prime velocity also increases. This is in contradiction to other conditions where there is an elevated ventricular end-diastolic pressure like restrictive cardiomyopathy or otherwise any other cause of LV dysfunction where the E by E prime ratio keeps increasing with increase in the pulmonary capillary wedge. So the E by E prime ratio, which usually corresponds to the PCWP in patients with heart failure, in constrictive pericarditis, it does not correspond because with worsening constriction, the E prime paradoxically increases. So this is called annulus paradoxus. Again, it's an important clinical finding. And also the reverse is annulus reverses, wherein normally the lateral annular velocity is more because the septum, the medial velocity is largely determined by the interventricular septum, which is contributed both by the LV and the RV. So if you're looking at medial velocities, normally the medial is less than the lateral, whereas in patients with constrictive pericarditis, the lateral velocity comes down because of tethering of the annulus to the pericardium, and this is called annulus reverses. So these two particular findings, if you are able to demonstrate them, it indicates that it is a case of constrictive pericarditis. Just a word about other modalities, which are actually very important nowadays. The role of CT and MRI has significantly increased in the last few years. CT and MRI help us to pick up pericardial thickening much better than echocardiography. So as I said, the cutoff value is more than 4 millimeters. It helps to quantify the pericardial effusion. Pericardial inflammation can be easily made out on MRI using the gadolinium enhancement. MRI has the additional advantage that it also gives us almost echocardiographic like images where you can actually see the septal bounce during the free breathing sequence. And there is one index described on MRI, which is called the relative atrial ratio. That is the ratio of the left atrial volume to the right atrial volume. This has been described as one of the markers favoring constrictive pericarditis. The role of MRI in restrictive cardiomyopathy has been already extensively described because you have specific gadolinium late enhancement patterns depending on the etiology of the restriction. I won't be going into those details. Just a few images of MRI, which so you can see here during inspiration and during expiration how the ventricular septum moves. So you can actually see the septal bounce in the running sequence, and you can see the enhancement of the pericardium very clearly on the MRI. Pericardial edema as well as pericardial enhancement can be easily made out on the MRI. So this is a very useful tool, and of late we have been using it for almost all our patients where we suspect constriction or restriction. Other investigations generally have a limited role. Endomyocardial biopsy is not a very useful tool. BNP has been found to be a predictor because BNP levels are generally higher in patients with RCM. This again correlates with higher end diastolic pressures, higher pulmonary systolic pressure, as well as more prominent dyspnea is a more prominent feature of RCM as compared to fatigue and constrictive pericarditis. So I would like to summarize what I have mentioned in all these slides. If we look at how we distinguish constriction from restriction, looking at clinical parameters, the JVP gives us a very very useful information on how to distinguish these two. Lab parameters, ECG and X-rays, largely non-specific, and there's a significant overlap of these findings. Probably the only exception, I think, which I didn't mention in my earlier slide, is the voltage and mass dissociation, which is very characteristic of amyloid heart disease, wherein the ventricle appears thickened on echocardiography or MRI, but the ECG voltages are very low. So this is one thing which can help us to maybe narrow in on amyloid or restrictive pathology. Otherwise, in constrictive pericarditis, usually the QRS amplitudes are small. Looking at echo and other imaging modalities, pericardial thickness is very important. We need to measure that. If there is wall thickness being increased, then it suggests a restrictive or infiltrative pathology. Look for atrial dilatation, that again favors RCM. Look for pericardial calcification. Try to look for the markers of ventricular interdependence, pulse wave Doppler, tissue Doppler, septal bounce. These are very important. And if at all we are going for invasive hemodynamics, you have to look for the discordant pattern, the spirophasic changes in the filling patterns in the left heart. So that helps us to diagnose constrictive pericarditis. So to conclude, both CP as well as restrictive cardiomyopathy have a significant clinical hemodynamic and echo features. They overlap significantly. So it's important for us to actively look for the pericardium, look for the thickness of the pericardium. As I said before, the caveat is 20% of them may not have a thickened pericardium. So the anatomical feature alone is not enough. We need to demonstrate the hemodynamics, the respirophasic changes and ventricular interdependence. Tissue Doppler is a very useful modality to distinguish the two entities. And in spite of having such a significant clinical overlap, both of them are distinct entities. One of them is largely treatable, that is CP, whereas restrictive cardiomyopathy, treatment options are limited, and usually transplant often remains the only viable option in advanced cases with RCM. So it's important for us to differentiate these entities and use the imaging modalities to reach a diagnosis, so we can at least pick up the patients with CP and send them for timely surgery. Thank you very much. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you, Kapil, for the excellent talk. And when usually our knowledge about this is restricted and constricted. many points made many points clear. Excellent talk. Must congratulate you. And also like diastolic democracy as a good talk. the constricted pericardium, there is unequal filling of the ventricles, but still we call diastolic because hemodynamics. Yeah. Any questions, comments from others?
Any questions from the?
Good evening, sir. This is Dr. Sudhakar from Manipal, sir.
Yeah, good evening, Sudhakar.
Yeah, very nice talk, sir. Very elaborate talk. I just wanted to know, we have so many modalities now to distinguish between, including the MRI and all CCP and RCM. How frequently do you use CAT study as a point for differentiation in the current practice at your center? Using a CAT study?
At our center, we still do it because we are a teaching hospital and... Right. More often than not, it's for academic interest, or in genuine cases where we are actually confused where the pericardium is not obviously looking thickened or calcified. And otherwise, largely we have switched to echo, that is advanced echo modalities as right. well as MRI.
Also, probably Kapil, apart from CAT study, you might require in very complicated case where you don't diagnose, go for biopsy. So, in that setting, the CAT into the biopsy.
Yes, yeah. If you're planning a biopsy, then we would also do a basic CAT. Again, to check the PA pressures, again, it's important. At least a right heart CAT study will help. Sometimes the surgeons ask us to do a CAT study to look at the coronaries or to look at to see the PA pressures. So in those conditions, we do it.
Right, sir. Thank you, sir.
Can MRI be normal in these cases when you are suspecting a restrictive physiology? Recently, we had a case, I think Dr. Iyengar also knows about it.
Can be normal.
Yeah, I think they said it is normal, sir. I think on that day. It was a restrictive physiology patient and they were suspecting restrictive cardiomyopathy. And MRI was reported to be normal. Apsara, is it the fact, no?
Sir, but is it possible that the patient was dehydrated and you were not able to elicit some?
No, she was completely with gross congestive failure. She had a large effusion also, pleural effusion.
I think, sir, one important thing to demonstrate the hemodynamics is that the hydration status should be optimal. That is, the patient should neither be dehydrated nor overhydrated. So if there's too much of congestion, then it can mask some of the clinical findings as well as the echo findings. So I think a little bit of optimal diuresis and then re-looking at the hemodynamics, I think, is what is recommended.
I think she was in a gross congestive failure. Large pleural effusion.
The patient is in gross failure. I think it's always better to treat the failure and bring, make the patient little euvolemic and then assess the dynamic parameters.
She was under treatment also, and even the effusion was tapped, almost 1 liter fluid.
This question is, MR, can it be normal in restrictive cardiomyopathy?
That is the
restrictive cardiomyopathy, sir. Okay, in restrictive cardiomyopathy, possibly it can be normal in the early stages, or if it's not a characteristic, a specific disease like amyloid or Fabry's or any of the other infiltrative, maybe then the MRI can be normal. But again, I'm not completely sure if
that's
correct.
I think it is, your talk was very nice and you have given a lot of points.
Thank you, sir.
I told regarding the annulus paradoxes, reverses, and tissue Doppler is very, very important in diagnosing these conditions. And thickening of the pericardium, of course, along with the echo, you may have to supplant with CT or MRI. I think that is the... So it's a multimodality. Along with the clinicals, you should apply all these findings because some may be seen, may not be seen. And that expiratory Doppler reversal, especially a mitral wall visualize the pulmonary veins. It's very, very important, this thing, along with tissue Doppler. Any other questions?
There's a question. There's a question from Tushar on how to differentiate COPD from constriction. I think the important thing in COPD is that there's a wide swing in the intrathoracic pressures, which is usually seen in the form of exaggerated flows in the SVC.
Yeah.
That does not happen in constrictive pericarditis. Because SVC flows are essentially not markedly changed in CP.
There's one more question there. I think you explained ventricular discordance and how to see it.
Yes, sir. Ventricular discordance is, invasive hemodynamics is needed to demonstrate, ventricular discordant filling, and also, as I mentioned, the systolic area index needs to be calculated to quantify the ventricular discordance. That has been one of the described indices. But clinically, if you want to look at ventricular discordance, it is just pulsus paradoxus is what we can do at the bedside to demonstrate.
The dynamic respiratory variation is also discordant in this constrictive prevention. Inspiration, expiration, and the dynamic respiratory variation is discordant in constrictive pericarditis. The other thing, you mentioned about briefly about the strain image. There, the both circumferential strain as well as the longitudinal strain, they are different.
Yes,
in
Yes, sir. So long, for the amount of time, I skipped that particular slide, but I'll just go back to.
It is more affected in CP rather
this
than.
Is the, this is the slide. Especially the important thing in strain imaging is that the longitudinal strain is preserved or it can be increased in patients with constrictive pericarditis. This is what correlates with the tissue Doppler time velocity. It correlates with the X descent on the JVP. This basically all of them indicate that the ventricle is vigorously contracting during systole. That's an important feature of CP, whereas in RPM that is decreased because the ventricle itself is diseased. So
that's an important thing. And between CT and MRI, I think MRI is less sensitive as far as the calcification is concerned.
Yes.
Regarding CT is concerned, CT is more
calcification. CT is the gold standard, whereas for thickening, MRI scores over CT.
You think so? Because somewhere I read that. Probably it includes even the physiological fluid in the its imaging, the MRI.
Yes, sir. I discussed this with our radiologist. So she said that MRI is better than CT for the thickening aspect.
Thickening.
With or without fluid, it gives a better measurement of the pericardial thickness. And the
just see one article in JACC about this constriction and restriction. In that, the author mentions about this MRI.
Yes.
Discuss with your radiologist.
A couple of very good review articles which I would recommend to students. One is the JACC article, which Iyengar sir is talking about 2016. It's a very, very good article on hemodynamics and overall to differentiate CP and RCM. Then there are a couple of hemodynamic papers. One is from Ames. That's again, I think most of the students would have already read that, hemodynamics of constrictive pericarditis.
And also from treatment point of view, of course, one of the etiological factors you mentioned about restrictive cardiopathy, one of them, the drug induced, also important to keep in mind because chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine is known to produce restrictive cardiopathy. That should be kept in mind. And
Yeah,
pericardial inflammation. So should detect that. Basically, you could easily find out about doing CRP and the ESR, but also by doing MR, where the endocardial late enhancement is there, epicardial late enhancement. So yes. These patients are better to enhance
therapy. And pericardial edema is also, one of the features that can be picked up on MRI, which is again an advantage of MRI over CT. That apart from thickening, you can also look at enhancement and edema, which can, because some of these patients may be in the early phase of the disease, you can actually give them steroids or anti-inflammatory drugs. Sometimes the surgeons don't want to operate when there is an active disease, like active tuberculosis. So they would, in those situations, MRI can actually tell us whether the disease is active or whether it's burnt out.
Yeah. They also, MRI also can tell better than CTP. Intramyocardial infiltration of the calcium, you get better information about it.
Yes.
And along with the FDG PET also, I think activity, all these things can be seen.
Yes.
And another thing they can the exam is the presence of AF.
Hmm.
Yes. X descent is lost, so yes. You go only by Y. And
AF might be good for the candidate. You can escape many of the questions and just say that patient is in AF.
Yes.
There's a question saying, is septal shudder and bounce the same? Yeah, they are the same. That's what I read in that article in JACC. There are words used for that entity.
The bounce, so it's the same, yeah. Why PASP never crosses 50 millimeter in constrictive pericarditis?
So in general, although it described that pulmonary hypertension is more common in RCM versus CP, most patients with CP will have some mild, at least mild pulmonary hypertension. Significantly PH basically indicates that the left ventricular end diastolic pressure is higher, and that correlates more with RCM because there is a myocardial pathology, the EDP is higher, the pulmonary capillary wedge is higher, and therefore the pulmonary systolic is higher in RCM. Otherwise, there is no, this, I think this value of 50 millimeters is, I think, quite random. And Iyengar sir, any comments on that?
Basically, there is every functional and restrictive cardiomyopathy. The function more or less not affected. Like, I mean, the interstitial pericarditis, the myocardial function more or less remains good, isn't it? Restrictive cardiomyopathy is the one where it can drop.
And if there's a left AV groove constriction, I think they can have in the constrictive pericarditis.
Yeah. Then they can have significant
pulmonary arterial hypertension, just like a mitral stenosis.
Or if it is end stage, if it's a mixed RCM with CP or end stage CP,
which disease, yeah,
has become fibrosed, then the pulmonary pressures will be high.
Correct.
Yeah, it has to be left-sided gross pathology.
Of course, pathology.
Right-sided, then the pulmonary arterial pressure.
Yes.
Maybe want to
any other comments or?
Very good presentation.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Ati, anything?
Nothing, sir. I think he has covered everything. Nothing to add, except you have also told regarding the torsion, strain, all these things. I think it's a good overall coverage. Very good talk.
Thank you.
Well appreciated.
Very good. Useful both for examination and practice, your cardiology practice.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Patil. Thanks, Kapil.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you. Good night.
Nice.
Good night to all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, officer.
Thank you, officer. Thank you.
Sir is on the key person. Thank you. Bye.